God, thank you so much. God, thank you for this group of people, God, that came together to serve here in Haiti this week. God, I pray that you'd go before us, God, that you'd use us, Lord, to build relationships, to point people towards you, God. And God, I pray that you would just show yourself through us. And God, I pray through this time that you would even teach us, God. God, that you'd reveal things to us that we didn't know before, God. God, I thank you for just the opportunity to serve you here in Haiti. We all see your name. Amen.
When I seen last year's video, when they went the last time, I knew that it was my time to go.
I made up my mind right then when I went last year, I'd be back anytime and every time I had a chance. I mean, it's just a standing call for me to go to Haiti as long as I'm breathing.
After having been in Haiti once, it was really hard for me to leave last year. I remember just feeling this emptiness, and the only thing that really kept me going was the fact that I knew that we were going to go again. It was already decided while we were there that we were going to make a commitment and would go again. And so this year, there wasn't any hesitation at all. You know, I knew that a group was going to go, and God willing, I was going to be part of that second group.
It just blew my mind. I mean, here we sit in our comfortable environment in our recliners watching our TV, and these people are having to pick up after a massive earthquake, and they do it with a smile on their face. I've seen people picking up trash where we would walk over it, and they done it for the love of their country. The people were amazing.
I thought I was prepared for the poverty in Haiti. I'd lived in the Philippines for a number of years and stayed in Southeast Asia for many years, and I'd seen poverty. And so whenever I first went, that didn't enter my mind that that would be have any shock value. Whenever I got there, it did. The earthquake was devastating, and I had never been a place that was in total ruin like it was there. Seeing the people living in tents, watching them take debris and build houses even in the middle of the median. When I first got there, I felt really overwhelmed at the poverty and what I saw. And so I think I did have a real shock the first time.
The most meaningful thing all week is church was great, the orphanage, everything was so great, and there's so many meaningful things happening this trip that it's hard to narrow that down to one, but it's probably the little boy at the orphanage. When he was just throwing a fit, crying and bawling and squalling, and nobody could please him. The other girls there that lived there with him every day, they would try to pick him up, and he didn't want them. He'd scream louder. And I reached down and picked him up, and he hushed, just like that, an instant. And that was it. He sat in my lap the rest of the hour or so we were there until I got ready to leave, and then he cried when they took him away from me. It was really weird. I had a connection, for sure, there with him, and it'll melt your heart. That was probably my most meaningful moment of this trip.
I had a young man ask me at the orphanage. He was an older young man. And in his broken English and my zero Creole, he wanted to make sure I knew Christ as my Lord and Savior. And I kind of went, in my mind, I'm thinking, isn't that my line? You know, isn't that my line? I mean, did I not come here to do that? And what really came home to me is that, you know, we're not going to take God to Haiti. We may find him there, but you're really not going to take God to Haiti. The people that we were around knew it in a personal way, in a depth that we don't really understand. So for me, it's always a spiritual experience, and I always feel like whenever I get back that I'm changed in ways that I'll never be the same person that I was whenever I went.
The main thing I think about is the people who saw us the second time. Their eyes would light up, and if they could speak English, they would say, "You came back." And if they couldn't speak English, they would say something to a translator, and the translator would turn to us and say, "We can't believe you came back." And to see that in their faces was worth the trip.
I would go back tomorrow if I was allowed to. I would go back twice a year if I was allowed to. I felt like it was a second home. The people, I felt more love there than I ever felt in the United States. And it was just the grace of God.
I think I even mentioned to someone, you know, if I get too old that I can't sling concrete and that's what's needed, I'll get in the empty bucket line. So I'm going to go back as long as I have breath and believe that it's God's will, then I'll continue to go back as long as I can.
I'm going back. Not will I, it's a matter of when. I'm going back and going back and going back again. It's like a second home. That's all there is to it. I miss the people. And the whole thing about it, whenever you think you could go and stay in the accommodations we do and take the cold showers we do and ready to come home when you want it, and then when you get home, you're ready to go back. So, sure, I'll go back. Can't wait.
And I intend to go as long as I have breath, like some others on our trip. We scheduled the next trip before we even got off of this trip, and we'll probably schedule the next trip before we get off of it. And we want to keep going back. The country is beautiful, but not nearly as beautiful as the people and the hearts of the people. I feel close to them, even though I can't speak the language, and someday I intend to learn that language. But I want to go back, and I want them to know that I will keep coming back as long as I have breath and as long as God allows me to.